Hi, Tony Selzel here. Welcome to The Line. You know, there are very, very few experts in this that we get to interview in this market, really in the Midwest, that have the intersection of sales, marketing, growth, tech, you know, the whole nine yards, like Tim Dixon. And Apex Consulting has been one of those companies that have been in some parallel swim lanes with StringCAN, doing some very unique things and acting, coming in and kind of dropping into these companies that are established, that have been in the game, but looking to get to that next level, looking for the exit, looking for where to, you know, how to create that leverageable point. Tim, how has your business evolved and what kind of got you to this place?
Yeah, Tony, basically after, you know, years of executive positions, 25 years in tech, East Coast, West Coast, we basically decided to retire back here, and I couldn't quit working, but focusing really on how do you help the small, medium-sized businesses, the established guys that have done fairly well. But what we found, and this is 7 years now at Apex, a lot of these businesses are just leaving money on the table.
Right.
Sad thing for the business owner.
Right, right. And when you go in and you're starting to work, I mean, because so many things have changed even in the last decade, right? I mean, we now have four generations in the workforce. You know, we've got, you know, trying to manage the millennials. I mean, that's a headache and a half right there, right? And even though we got one behind the camera, the what we're trying to do, and you as a consultant, what is the three things that you just, God, they just want to pull out your hair, right? And help them see the world differently. How do you help them see that, go from that flat world to the round world?
Yeah. So, if you look at the typical business owner, they have gaps usually, right? So it's either in kind of the finance side, do they even understand it? Operational side, or growth, marketing, outreach side. Mm-hmm. And so really what we try to do is assess where that business owner is, mm-hmm. and see if where, you know, what knobs they have to turn to improve value in their business.
Right.
And you talk about generations. I mean, that's a good point. I mean, you know, right now some stats show that, you know, as the baby boomer generation moves and those businesses transition, there's a transfer of wealth of about $10 trillion just in North America alone.
Right.
And unfortunately, a lot of these business owners, they get to the end of their business life, whether they're tired or what, they basically just walk away from the business and really don't understand what are the things that they need to do to improve and have a profit stream that someone else wants to take over, and they can get the greatest value out of their business.
Well, and one of the things I think you've done a great job, and I've seen with the companies I've seen you work with, is really come in and become that catalyst, that leverageable point where the organization can get to that next level. And I want to speak to a little bit about the vacuum that's coming, right? I mean, we were doing some research for the new book that we're writing, and one of the things it said in Fortune 5000 has at age of experience amongst the employees, in the next decade, 62% of it's going to walk out the door and retire. I mean, think about that. I mean, you've got guys that have 20 years doing what they're doing, getting replaced with people that got two. And that is,
that
is crazy when you think about that.
The change in the business landscape is just going to be amazing.
Right.
And those folks that are either retiring or are part of that vacuum, as you said, as these businesses close down, transition, whatever, they need really from their standpoint to realize, hey, you know, I can become an entrepreneur too, right? I mean, even after many years of business life, that's a possibility for me. But again, to make sure that those businesses close down, change correctly. I mean, I was in front of a business owner just yesterday, and a friend, but you know, we probably hadn't talked in 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
And he said, Tim, you know, I'm now 5 years away from retirement. He's run his business for 30 years, very successful here in the Midwest. And he basically said, my goal is to pay off my debt and walk out the door. And I'm going, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
You know, you have a very profitable business,
right?
You know, 20% net profit, And that profit stream translates to something in your pocket if you would do something about it, right, and understand what you can do in the next 3 to 5 years to make that, you know, really valuable to someone else.
Wind out at zero should not be your goal, right? I mean, that's crazy. Well, and I'll tell you that, so that there's one end, right? And here's the other end, and I know you run into this too. You get, there's the curse of being brilliant. So you get somebody who is brilliant at building a one aspect of the business. Let's say it's an engineer. Let's say it's a top producer. Let's say it's the architect of a great product, right? The inventor, right, if you will. And then Tim, they think they're brilliant at everything, right? And so in those areas where they're not brilliant, they're very weak, or they're just good. And the enemy of great is good, right? And so, I mean, talk to me about where you see organizations that can't recognize where their weaknesses are and to put people in there that have exceptional strength.
Yeah, and actually, you know, that's really one of the things that it comes down to, being a very good consultant. You know, and a good consultant is able to, I don't know, slap the owner on the face a little bit, mm-hmm, you know, help them realize from a third party objective view exactly where the issues are. Mm-hmm. And you're right, a lot of it is emotional, and it's really helping them transition through that phase, that change phase that they need to go through. Mm-hmm. You know, again, another example of a company that we had here in the Midwest, you know, we did some outreach and marketing for them, mm-hmm, you know, really trying to diversify what they were doing because they were a single industry company. They didn't like the ups and downs. They ended up, you know, we did it well enough that they got some notoriety. They were on the Inc. 2000 list 2 years in a row. They got purchased by the third largest oil services firm in the world. But you would not believe, even though many of these, you know, a dozen of them walked away as multimillionaires, how hard was it for them to make that decision that they should do that?
Yeah.
It was excruciatingly hard. And you had young executives, mm-hmm, and you had the older founders. They had to meet, you know, right, at the middle of, you know, how this transition works. Mm-hmm. And the, you know, a lot of them just helping them understand, hey, you know, it is a change, mm-hmm, but don't be afraid of that change.
That
fear and navigating through that fear issue, you see that all the time in business.
Well, you have that knack, and this is very similar to the kind of conversation we have with our clients. You almost got to hold their hand and still be able to dunk their head in the water, right? You know, you're going to hold their hand,
exactly,
and you got to dunk their head in the water. You're like, I still love you, but you know, you need to do this. And it's because it's lonely run, and you know, it's lonely in the C-suite. It really is, right? So we got 2 minutes. I want to talk to you about one thing, and I think you're gonna get this in about 5 minutes or 5 seconds. I'm reading a great new book. It's called The Hard Thing About Hard Things. If you haven't heard of it, it's a great read. But he speaks, and he does this thing about wartime and peacetime CEOs, and that you're a completely different human being when you're in each one of those levels. What is that? When you hear that, and you know that that's where that some of the clients you gotta kind of walk in both,
yeah,
you know, both shoes.
Yeah.
What does that mean to you?
Well, you know, I might translate it wrong compared to what the book says.
Yeah.
But again, I'll give you another example. I just got off the phone with a CEO out of Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, after 7 years and doing very well in the business, decided he was not the one,
right?
I mean, he was able to take the business only so far,
mm-hmm,
and now it has the chance for significant growth.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, he's too conservative, and he still runs it like a small business.
Right.
He doesn't understand, how do you invest for growth? How do you expand for growth and not let growth kill you?
Right.
So, you know, he did very well in kind of the peacetime, kind of the small, you know, not a lot of pressure. But now that company has gotten larger and he's had some, you know, board demands that he didn't see before, mm-hmm, and expectations,
mm-hmm,
now he's a CEO that's not ready for wartime.
Right. Well, Wynn, if you're that CEO, if you're out there and you're listening to this, I mean, first off, that's the hardest job going. I mean, being a CEO of a growing business is like, it's like literally having 2 feet in a canoe and trying to row upstream, right? And you got to have somebody in your court, you know, find somebody like Tim who's been there and done that. To help you learn that skill, because it's one of the hardest things you can do. And I think that's one of the things that, you know, they got to surround themselves with people like you that will tell it like it is.
Yeah, and people like you that will help them in terms of understanding one of those three areas, and that's kind of the marketing, growth, outreach piece that oftentimes they just, you know, don't have the sales experience and are not executing on very well.
Right. Yeah. I appreciate the plug, man. Thanks for being on the show.
Okay.